Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The OCD Workbook, 3rd edition, Your Guide to Breaking Free from Obsessive-Compulsive Disorder, by Bruce M. Hyman, PhD, and Cherry Pedrick, RN. Narrated by Sarah Sampino. Publisher's note: this audiobook includes bonus material. Please visit tantor.com and type The OCD Workbook, 3rd edition, into the search box. Follow the link to the book's page. Then, under the supplemental content section, please enter the access code VALUE, and then click the unlock button to access the bonus material. The code should be entered in all lowercase letters. All worksheets, tables, charts, forms, examples, and resources referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Publisher's note: this publication is designed to provide accurate and authoritative information in regard to the subject matter covered. It is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering psychological, financial, legal, or other professional services. If expert assistance or counseling is needed, the services of a competent professional should be sought. Introduction. The great thing in this world is not so much where we are, but in what direction we are moving. Oliver Wendell Holmes. The OCD Workbook has been a valuable resource for people with OCD, their families, and clinicians for over a decade. This third edition discusses even more variants of the OCD spectrum and has been updated to reflect some of the latest trends in cognitive behavioral treatment. We've also added more help and guidance for family members struggling with OCD in a loved one. If you are seeking a greater understanding of OCD and how to overcome it, this book can help. Who we are. I have to go back. I have to go back and see if I locked the door. I stared at the door of our house. I had to check it again. Turning off the ignition, I jumped out of the car. I saw you lock it, Mom. My son James called after me, obviously annoyed. He didn't want to be late for school again. You checked it twice. I knew I had locked the door. I always locked it. So why did I need to check it again? I couldn't explain, I just had to check again. This happened more and more often, until I was regularly returning home just to see if the doors were locked. In the middle of the day, without warning, my fears would hit me. Did I lock the door? Did I turn off the coffee pot, the lights? Soon I was checking and rechecking appliances, locks, car brakes, and paperwork. When the constant checking began to interfere with my job as a home health nurse, I sought treatment. I was diagnosed with obsessive-compulsive disorder, OCD. As a nurse, I was somewhat familiar with obsessive-compulsive disorder, but I wasn't prepared for the struggle ahead. My need to recover motivated me to read every book and article about OCD I could find. This led to writing several magazine articles and a continuing education home study course for nurses. The research and writing helped me apply cognitive behavioral therapy principles to my own illness. As my OCD improved, I reached out to others who were struggling with OCD, and I met many people who were suffering from a lack of knowledge and support. I discovered support systems on the internet and through the Obsessive Compulsive Foundation, now the International OCD Foundation. Help is available for people struggling with OCD. But there is a great need to get information to the people who need it. My brilliant computer nerd son offered to make a website for me. A website? What would I do with a website? I soon found out. He made a beautiful homepage dedicated to educating others about OCD. Thousands of people have stopped by my website at cherrypedrick.com, spelled CHERRYPEDRICK.com, on their educational journey. From there, links lead to the best OCD sites on the internet. Today, after applying what I've learned about cognitive behavioral therapy, my OCD seems to be gone. However, I remain on guard for fleeting urges to needlessly check on something or wash my hands. Giving in once too often could unleash an OCD monster once again. I met Dr. Bruce Hyman, a psychotherapist specializing in OCD, at the 1997 Obsessive-Compulsive Foundation conference. He was writing a book, a workbook designed to give people with OCD the tools to work on their problem. For the previous 2 years, he had been seeking a medical professional with OCD who could write about the experience of having OCD from the patient's point of view. We discovered we could each fill a need in writing a book about OCD. Together, the two of us bring important expertise to this project. My nursing background helps me understand the medical aspects of OCD and its treatment. Having the disorder myself helps me relate the information with compassion and understanding. We believe that this combined expertise is one reason why this book has been so successful. I'm thankful for the opportunity to update the workbook so that it can continue to assist people in recovering from OCD. Charlene Cherry Pedrick, RN. No, I don't have OCD. But in 1987, after I'd been conducting a general clinical psychotherapy practice for 7 years, a middle-aged male was referred to me for treatment of severe washing and checking rituals. He took 2-hour showers, obsessively avoided touching unfamiliar objects, feared dirt and germs, and washed his hands 75 times a day. Having never been consulted previously by a person with OCD, I was baffled by his strange behavior and moved by his profound suffering. When I realized that my traditional training was ill-suited to truly helping him, I embarked upon a mission to learn everything I could about OCD and to seek guidance from whomever in the country might have specialized knowledge of it. In 1988, this led me to the Anxiety Disorders Unit at the former Medical College of Pennsylvania, now the Drexel University College of Medicine, directed by Dr. Edna Foa, who was presently on the faculty of the University of Pennsylvania School of Medicine, and in 2010 was voted among the top 100 most influential people in the world by Time magazine. There I observed the successful use of intensive behavioral treatment methods with OCD patients. Having a previous foundation in cognitive behavioral treatment methods, in time, I was able to adopt the methods for use with my own OCD patients. Subsequently, I received several years of ongoing clinical case consultation from Dr. Blanche Freund. In 1992, I established the OCD Resource Center of Florida, with offices in Fort Lauderdale, Hollywood, Miami, and Boca Raton, Florida. Presently, approximately 90% of my busy practice is devoted to the treatment of adults and children with OCD and related disorders. The idea of writing a book on OCD grew out of my awareness that very few people with OCD are receiving the proper help. Although our culture has come a long way toward greater understanding and destigmatization of psychiatric disorders, including OCD, much fear and ignorance persists. Far too many people struggling with OCD fear the embarrassment and discomfort of seeking help and confronting the disorder. Those who do seek help for OCD are often disappointed by the results. Many of my patients report having sought help from several well-intentioned but misinformed healthcare professionals before finding someone truly knowledgeable about OCD. Due to the often desperate nature of the disease, people will seek help from almost any source that offers the remotest hope for relief. Frequently, these disappointing encounters with the healthcare system result in further emotional pain, guilt, discouragement, and mistrust. Many give up hope and lose confidence in their ability to break free from the power OCD has over their lives. There is still no medical cure. You will probably still have OCD after listening to this book, but you also will have the weapons you need to fight against the disorder. My goal in writing this book is to help people with OCD get on track in their battle with OCD by guiding them step by step through the process of change. Most of the treatment techniques in this book are not new. They have been presented in other self-help books, as well as in clinical texts for professional psychologists. The OCD Workbook brings the best and most effective of these techniques together in one book, and also presents current theories about behavioral change processes in clear and understandable language. It is the product of more than 20 years of experience treating over 1,000 people with every conceivable type of OCD. Bruce M. Hyman, PhD, licensed clinical social worker. How this book can help you. The bonus PDF includes worksheets, exercises, charts, tables, and resources for you. The OCD Workbook isn't intended as a substitute for psychiatric or psychological treatment by a qualified mental health professional. Rather, it should be used in the following ways. In conjunction with ongoing psychiatric or psychological treatment. For example, you may be seeing a professional who is highly qualified but who doesn't specialize in treating OCD. In addition to being helpful to you as you work through the steps toward gaining control of your OCD, this book can assist your therapist in coaching, guiding, or advising you. By people reluctant to seek professional help. People with OCD are often reluctant to seek professional help, even if it's available to them. There are often feelings of shame and embarrassment at the notion of seeking the services of a mental health professional. You may be inhibited by the notion that seeking help would be an admission that you might be crazy. Many people with OCD obsess that they may be crazy and fear that the doctor will only confirm their worst nightmare. This can make seeking help unthinkable. We hope that this book will help you shed many of the myths and misconceptions about what OCD is and how it's treated. Its aim is to start you down the road towards self-directed treatment, or, if necessary, to help you seek out qualified help without shame or embarrassment. By people with OCD who want to help themselves but don't know how to go about doing it, or those who don't have access to qualified treatment. You may have a desire to learn as much about OCD as possible and wish to use this book as a guide for self-directed intervention. If you think you have OCD, we urge you to seek out the services of a mental health professional who is experienced in the diagnosis and treatment of OCD. Chapter 19 provides guidance on finding a qualified mental health professional. A psychiatrist or psychologist can verify the diagnosis of OCD and help you decide if self-directed cognitive behavioral therapy is appropriate for you. As discussed in Chapter 16, certain other illnesses sometimes co-occur with OCD and can complicate recovery. With some of these illnesses, it may be important to develop a comprehensive treatment strategy that addresses each diagnosis. By family members seeking a greater understanding of OCD. Just as it is not recommended that a doctor treat his or her own family for diseases, we recommend that family members not try to take on the role of psychotherapist to a loved one using this book, even if trained as therapists. However, family members can provide valuable support as the person with OCD works through the self-help process outlined in this book. Chapter 4 describes how a trusted friend or family member can play the role of behavioral assistant, and Chapter 18 is devoted to how family members can help. In addition, each chapter includes a section specifically aimed at family and friends. About this book. The OCD Workbook is divided into four parts. After listening to Part 1, Chapters 1 through 3, you will understand what OCD is, how it is diagnosed, what the symptoms are, and how the disorder is currently treated. These chapters discuss the most commonly accepted theories about the causes of OCD. Chapter 3 contains a review of the most effective treatments for OCD, medication, and cognitive behavioral therapy. Part 2, chapters 4 through 9, is the heart of this book, providing step-by-step instructions to guide you through the self-directed program for combating OCD. These chapters discuss attitudes that can help or hinder recovery. They also address realistic expectations regarding progress, especially the need for tolerance and patience with yourself. When you commit to the self-directed program, you'll need to set aside a period of 3 to 6 weeks during which the program will be a top priority in your life. The reward of freedom from the distress of OCD will make this sacrifice worthwhile. Note that we don't say freedom from OCD, but freedom from the distress. You'll find that you can live a more productive and fulfilling life with a little bit of OCD in your life than you can with a lot of OCD. Part 2 includes instructions for using the OCD workbook alone or with a therapist functioning as a coach. It also discusses how to determine whether you need professional counseling. If you don't have a therapist available for support, a trusted friend or family member can take on the role of behavioral assistant. In this edition, Part 2 also includes a new Chapter 9, Acceptance and Mindfulness Approaches to OCD. This chapter presents material on the third wave of cognitive behavioral therapy, including the use of acceptance and commitment therapy, ACT, for OCD, an approach that is gaining increasing recognition within the mental health field. Part 3, chapters 10 through 17, offers an introduction to specific symptoms and disorders within the OCD spectrum. It isn't necessary for you to listen through all of Part 3. Feel free to skip to whatever chapter or chapters are most relevant to you. In this part of the book, you'll learn powerful strategies for coping with less common but debilitating OCD symptoms and disorders related to OCD. These include primarily obsessional OCD, scrupulosity, hit-and-run OCD, health-related anxiety, and hoarding. Part 4, chapters 16 through 19, includes valuable information on disorders related to OCD, family issues, and gives detailed information that will assist you in reaching out to others for help. Chapter 16 discusses some of the so-called spectrum disorders related to OCD, including body dysmorphic disorder and trichotillomania, hair pulling. Because OCD happens to children too, Chapter 17 provides information on how to apply the principles in this book to OCD in children. Your family can play an important role in your recovery, so Chapter 18 is devoted to this important topic. In addition, in this revised edition of the book, we've included a new section entitled Help for Family and Friends at the end of each chapter. We encourage you to share this information with your closest friends and family members. Depending on your situation, you may also need professional help. Chapter 19 offers guidance in selecting a qualified mental health professional. And because support groups can also be quite helpful in overcoming the shame and isolation that often accompany OCD, Chapter 19 outlines resources that can assist you in locating OCD support groups in your area. The appendix also contains valuable resources. Certain people in your life may be clueless when it comes to OCD and wonder why you act strangely. Or maybe you've kept your OCD secret, so coming out will be a surprise to the people in your life. Therefore, the appendix contains a concise description of the disorder that you may copy and give to teachers, school counselors, family members, spiritual advisors, and other people who might benefit from this information. The appendix also contains the Yale-Brown Obsessive-Compulsive Scale, YBOCS, a self-administered rating scale that helps determine the degree of severity of OCD symptoms. Each item asks about some dimension of how symptoms interfere with day-to-day life. The range of scores is from 0 to 40, with 40 representing the most severe level of OCD symptoms. Consider the YBOCS to be something like a snapshot of your present level of symptoms. It's a good idea to take the YBOCS at the beginning of the self-directed program, midway through, and at a point when you've completed a significant amount of work on your OCD. It can give you a good idea of how far you've come and how far you still need to go in reducing the interference of symptoms in your daily life. Part 1. Learning about OCD. Chapter 1. What is OCD? Its many faces. There is perhaps nothing so bad and so dangerous in life as fear. Jawaharlal Nehru. The people you will meet in this chapter are representative of the millions of people who have obsessive-compulsive disorder, or OCD. They struggle with a neurobehavioral disorder that fills their minds with unwanted thoughts and threatens them with doom if they don't perform repetitive, senseless rituals. They are not a rare group. About 1 in 40 people has OCD. In the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, obsessive-compulsive disorder is placed within the class of psychiatric disorders known as anxiety disorders. Other anxiety disorders include panic disorder, social phobia, simple phobia, generalized anxiety disorder, and post-traumatic stress disorder. OCD is characterized by obsessions and/or compulsions that are time-consuming, distressing, and/or interfere with normal routines, relationships, or daily functioning. Obsessions are persistent, unwanted thoughts, images, or urges that intrude into a person's thinking and cause excessive worry and anxiety. Compulsions are covert mental acts or overt behaviors performed repetitively to relieve or prevent the worry or anxiety generated by the obsession. They often have the intent of magically preventing or avoiding some dreaded event, such as death, illness, or some other perceived misfortune. Forms of OCD. OCD has many faces, but the patterns of thoughts and behaviors of people with the disorder are remarkably and unmistakably consistent. The most common symptoms associated with OCD are checking, washing and cleaning, ordering and repeating, hoarding, and scrupulosity. Some people who suffer from OCD don't seem to engage in these behaviors, at least not overtly. This is known as primarily obsessional OCD. Checking. Those who engage in checking live with an excessive, irrational sense of being held responsible for possible dangers and catastrophes that may befall themselves or others as a result of their imperfect, incomplete, or careless actions. They feel compelled to repeatedly check that, for example, doors and windows are locked, the stove and iron are turned off, the coffee maker is unplugged, or the garage door is down. They will check over and over until they get a just right feeling or a sense of assurance that disaster will be averted. They might also repeatedly check on loved ones to make sure they haven't caused harm to them. Checking compulsions also occur within the context of health-related obsessions. For example, repeatedly checking one's heart rate or blood pressure for evidence of abnormalities that could signify the presence of a catastrophic illness. Checking relieves the anxiety brought on by the obsessive thoughts, but the relief is short-lived. The worries often return or are replaced by similar obsessive thoughts, calling for more checking. A vicious cycle is thus created. Anxiety, followed by checking, which results in limited relief, then a return of the anxiety, followed by even more checking, and on and on. Washing and cleaning. People who wash and clean excessively have obsessions about the possibility of contamination by dirt, germs, viruses, or foreign substances. They live with a near constant dread of either causing harm to others or to themselves, or failing to prevent it. In response to their fear-provoking thoughts, they excessively wash their hands, shower, or clean their homes for hours on end. Over time, fears compound as they perceive more possibilities for harm. The washing and cleaning become more and more elaborate, and yet bring less and less relief. Ordering and repeating. Those who engage in ordering and cleaning might feel they must arrange certain items in a particular, exact, perfect way. Or they might repeat particular actions over and over until they feel just right. Many demand that particular objects, such as their shoelaces, hair, or personal belongings, be perfectly even or symmetrical. They become extremely distressed if their things are moved, touched, or rearranged even slightly. Obsessive thoughts or fears of harm coming to them or a loved one can lead to a frenzy of ordering or repeating certain behaviors over and over. They might cross over a room threshold repeatedly, count or repeat words silently, rearrange items, or turn light switches on and off until it feels just right. Only then will the obsessive thoughts or fears subside, if only for a few moments. Scrupulosity. People with scrupulosity obsess about religious, ethical, or moral issues. They demand a code of conduct from themselves that goes well beyond that of most people who subscribe to their beliefs. Their compulsions may involve excessive praying and repeatedly, needlessly seeking reassurance of their moral purity from others, usually priests, ministers, or rabbis. Rather than providing peace and freedom from the anxiety, these compulsions actually bring on even more anxiety, as the OCD demands more perfect adherence to religious rules and practices, triggers even more reassurance seeking, and leads to other rituals to relieve the doubts. Hoarding. Those with hoarding collect insignificant items and have difficulty throwing away things that most people would consider junk. They develop a strong attachment to their hoarded items and overvalue their importance. Often they are afraid they might need the items at some vague time in the distant future. For these people, letting go of things can cause so much distress that it's easier just to keep them. This results in chaotic and unbearable living conditions in which there is little usable space in the house that isn't taken up with junk. Primarily obsessional OCD. Those with primarily obsessional OCD experience unwanted, intrusive, horrific thoughts and images of causing danger or harm to others, and sometimes even themselves. The themes are almost always of a violent or sexual nature. Or they may have unwanted thoughts of acting upon a sexual impulse towards others in a manner that is clearly disgusting and repulsive even to them. The term primarily obsessional OCD implies the presence of obsessive thoughts without accompanying overtly performed compulsions. Research over the past 20 years has revealed that most people with primarily obsessional OCD do indeed perform compulsions, but they are subtle, covert behaviors, such as mental compulsions or rituals. For example, many engage in repetitive thoughts, such as counting, praying, or repeating certain words, to counteract their anxious thoughts. They may also mentally review situations obsessively to ward off doubt and relieve anxiety. Or they may excessively monitor and scrutinize the feelings in their genitals for any feelings of arousal in unwanted circumstances. They often repeatedly ask others for reassurance that they aren't going to harm someone. As with checkers, washers, orderers, and repeaters, these mental rituals offer only temporary relief from the anxiety brought on by intrusive thoughts. With time, the relief lessens, anxiety mounts, and mental rituals may become more elaborate and time-consuming. Many people can identify with all these forms of OCD to some extent. Who hasn't checked to see whether the door is locked a second time, or shuddered from a disturbing or frightening thought that occurs out of the blue? One person's prized, dusty old newspaper collection may be a pile of worthless junk to another. When these thoughts, feelings, and behaviors cause significant distress or result in marked interference with one's daily living, OCD could be the problem. Maybe you have a few of the symptoms described before, but they don't seem to interfere significantly with your life. Listen on. You may realize that your habits do indeed interfere with your life way more than you realized. But even if your symptoms aren't severe enough to warrant a diagnosis of OCD, you may benefit from the same cognitive behavioral therapy principles used to help people with full-blown OCD. It's common for people with OCD to suffer from a variety of OCD symptoms. For example, Cherry Pedrick had problems with checking, mental rituals, and hand washing. Many people with OCD may have one predominant symptom for years, only to have it go away and then have another one begin. For example, someone who has been a washer for many years may lose the fear of contamination and become a checker, or vice versa. There is no typical pattern. However, a change in the form of the OCD symptoms over time does appear to be the norm. The face of OCD. Now we'd like to introduce you to people with OCD so you can see how these symptoms affect people in their daily lives. Except for Cherry, these people are composites of many people with OCD. You may observe similarities between yourself and one or more of the people described, but this is only coincidental. Cherry's story. What if? An unwanted companion. My struggle with OCD began with the fear that I hadn't locked the door when I left the house. After some time passed, my need to check and worry increased until it invaded my entire life. I frequently and repeatedly returned to the house to check the door, coffee pot, or stove. Away from home, I often stopped what I was doing and returned to my car to make sure the emergency brake was set and the door was locked. What if scenarios became my constant companions? What if I left the car door unlocked and a child got inside the car and then got hurt? What if I didn't set the brake and the car was bumped from behind and rolled forward and hurt someone? My obsessions revolved around the fear that I had done something, or hadn't done something, that could result in harm to others. I also had a problem with hand washing when I prepared meals, fearing that I might contaminate the food. Now, over 15 years after OCD became my constant unwanted companion, I can say that I've broken free from OCD. As I used the techniques Dr. Hyman and I have written about, my OCD became more and more bearable, and then gradually faded. In addition, I've used spiritual techniques and practices to help me let go of obsessive thoughts and resist compulsions. Mary's story. Obsessive fears of becoming gravely ill from a disease took over Mary's life when her oldest son contracted a life-threatening virus. She began to avoid blood, dirt, germs, and red spots for fear of the possibility, no matter how remote, of getting sick and not being able to take care of her son. Her fears grew for 5 years before she sought treatment. By that time, Mary was washing her hands about 100 times a day, and her daily showering ritual took about 1 full hour. She avoided going near hospitals, clinics, and doctor's offices because she considered them contaminated. Certain streets were off-limits, too. Streets where homeless people were likely to hang out, because she felt that homeless people were more likely to have open sores than people with homes. She avoided anything that might have a red spot on it, in case the spot might be camouflaging a bloodstain. Mary only felt truly comfortable in certain sections of her own home that she considered safe and clean. These areas were off limits to other family members, especially her husband. Because he worked for a delivery company and made daily deliveries to local hospitals, Mary considered him to be contaminated. When he came home from work, he had to shower immediately and put his clothes in the washing machine so Mary wouldn't have to touch them. Melody's story. Melody couldn't remember a time when she didn't check excessively. She didn't consider her checking behavior to be a problem until she went to college and moved out of her parents' home into a small apartment with a roommate. At first, her roommate was thankful for Melody's concern. It made her feel safe to see Melody check the door, stove, and appliances every night. However, Melody's nightly rituals grew longer as more and more items were added to the list of things that had to be checked every night. Her roommate grew alarmed when she saw that Melody was checking the windows, which were always locked, and looking in the backs of closets and under the beds. Also, everything had to be checked in a certain order. If Melody was interrupted or her concentration was broken, she started over. And sometimes she started over just because it didn't feel right. Melody also made copies of her coursework and kept them in a box. In the evenings, she checked these copies over and over, afraid she had missed a crucial point or had written something offensive. She called home 3 or 4 times a day to check on her parents and little brother. She also checked on her friends and others she had associated with during the day. Had she said the wrong thing? Had she harmed someone by coughing with her mouth uncovered? Entire evenings were often spent reviewing the day's events, looking for mistakes she might have made and ways she might have harmed someone. Robert's story. Checking was a problem for Robert, too, but most of his checking compulsions revolved around driving. One night, he saw a man standing in the median between the lanes. Robert glanced in the rearview mirror and saw the man dart across the road behind his car. Had he hit him? He looked back and didn't see him on the other side of the street. Robert made a U-turn at the next intersection and went back. He drove slowly by the spot where he had seen the man. Although he didn't see a dead or injured body, he still wasn't sure, so he turned around and drove by again. An hour later, he was late for his appointment and still unsure. He went home and waited anxiously for the evening television news. Surely they would report an accident if someone had been injured. A week later, Robert drove by a woman riding a bicycle in the bike lane. Again, he was jolted by the thought that he might have hit her. He looked in the rearview mirror. She was still there, riding calmly, oblivious to his fears. Soon he was looking back and checking his mirror whenever he passed pedestrians and bicyclists. He got into the habit of watching the 11 o'clock news each night to check for accidents in areas where he had driven. Ben's story. As a child, Ben had organized the toys in his room very carefully. Toy soldiers went in a box. Puzzles had their own place on the bookshelf. His books were sorted on the shelves according to their size. Short ones on the right, taller ones on the left. At school, the other children had whispered about Ben's rituals. He had placed his books under his chair in the same spot every day. His pencil always had a sharp point and was positioned at the top of his desk exactly in the middle. He kept an eraser on the upper right corner, not too close to the edge. His papers always were arranged carefully in the middle of his desk. As an adult, Ben rarely had visitors in his home. It was too much effort to put things back in order after they left. He couldn't enjoy the few visits family members made because of the anxiety he experienced when something was moved out of its place. Jack's story. Going through the thresholds of doors was Jack's difficulty. If he had a bad thought or something just didn't feel right, he had to go back and walk through the door again. When he passed through a doorway, he had to touch the right side, then the left, then the top of the doorway. If he felt okay, he walked through the door. If it didn't feel right, he took a step back, then a step forward, and then he repeated his touching ritual. Sitting in a chair or standing up from a chair also involved a ritual. First, Jack touched the floor, then both sides of the chair, then he stood. Writing took a lot of effort and time. He had to retrace each letter twice. Consequently, everything took Jack much longer than most people. He set his alarm for 3 a.m. so he could leave the house by 7. Every minute task involved in getting dressed and groomed had to be done just right. Mark's story. Guilt plagued Mark constantly. When bad thoughts, usually of a blasphemous or sexual nature, came to his mind, he prayed. But the prayer had to be right, or it wouldn't work. So the prayers had to be repeated over and over until they felt just right. It was particularly painful to Mark that his bad thoughts invaded his mind most often while he was in church. As a result, he was tempted to stay away from church and to give up his belief in God completely. But he also feared that if he left the church, that would make him feel even guiltier. Liz's story. One person's trash is another person's treasure. For years, Liz justified her collection of stuff by repeating this phrase. But most of the items stashed in the boxes that lined her apartment were no one's treasures, and over time the boxes became a burden. Liz tried to solve the problem by moving. She put the boxes in storage and started over, but her new apartment quickly filled with boxes too. Liz saved newspapers, magazines, receipts, and mail, even the years-old advertisements and catalogs that filled her mailbox. She wasn't sure why she saved things, but the thought of throwing anything away made her feel extremely anxious. Liz was deeply embarrassed and hadn't had a visitor to her home in many years, which strained her friendships, as she made up excuses for never inviting her friends over. Angelita's story. Angelita, a 33-year-old mother with a 2-year-old daughter, was preparing lunch. She picked up a knife to cut a tomato and suddenly, out of the blue, the thought of plunging the knife into her daughter popped into her mind. Horrified by such a thought, she was overwhelmed by intense feelings of guilt. The thought returned the next day, again while she was in the kitchen. That evening, while bathing her daughter, the thought, "What if I drown my baby?" popped into her head. Again, the thought deeply disturbed her. For the next several days, over and over again, she thought, "I must be a horrible mother to think such terrible thoughts. I'd better do whatever I can to stop these thoughts." To keep herself from thinking such disturbing thoughts, she distracted herself by repeating, "I'm a good mother and I'd never do that," over and over in her mind. But still the thoughts recurred, growing stronger and stronger. Whenever she was alone with her daughter, she felt anxious. She began to avoid touching knives or anything sharp in the presence of her little girl. And she made sure that her mother, who didn't know about the distressing thoughts, was present whenever she bathed her daughter. Ron's story. Ron was also plagued by unwanted thoughts. In his mind, certain images played over and over like a continuous movie. They scared him because he feared they would come true. In these thoughts, he was harming someone violently, usually his wife, but also his co-workers and even his closest friends, whomever he was with at the time. He knew in his heart that he didn't have any desire to harm anyone, so he was baffled as to why these thoughts played so strongly in his mind. He could be enjoying a movie or a meal with his family or friends, or just talking to a coworker, and the thoughts would burst into his mind. He developed a strategy of clenching his hands together tightly when the thoughts occurred, which caused severe muscle and joint soreness. He worried constantly that he was losing his mind or going crazy. The story of your struggle with OCD. You have just heard some typical stories of people with OCD. Now, in this exercise, you'll write your own story. Write it as if you are talking to someone safe, like your closest friend, someone you feel confident would never reject, judge, or criticize you for what you write. Permit yourself to express all of your thoughts and feelings about your life with OCD. purchase a notebook to use as a journal and write your story there as your first entry. If you're afraid someone will read your story, write it in your journal or on a separate sheet of paper, and after completing the exercise, place what you've written in an envelope and store it safely away. One day, when you are truly free from OCD, you'll see this exercise as one of the first important milestones on your road to recovery. OCD through the ages. In the first half of the 20th century, OCD was known by such names as compulsion neurosis and obsessional neurosis. Obsessive-compulsive disorder was once thought to be a rare disease. In 1964, researchers estimated OCD affected only 0.05% of the population, 1 out of 2,000 people. In 1977, the estimate was 0.32%, 3 out of 1,000 people. Major studies now estimate a lifetime prevalence of 2.5%. Much of the reason for the previously low estimates of OCD prevalence lies in the secrecy of people who have the disorder. Sigmund Freud, the founder of psychoanalysis, believed OCD was a psychological disorder caused by internal conflict and used the psychoanalytic technique of the talking cure to treat it. Over the decades, the results from this form of treatment generally weren't good, and OCD became known as a disorder that was difficult to treat. Freud admitted being puzzled by OCD. And even as he continued to promulgate his psychological theories, he looked toward a future when a more thorough understanding of the brain's chemistry and anatomy would play an important role in understanding psychiatric illnesses. That future is here. Psychology has moved from theories of the mind to research on the brain. Modern technological advances include techniques like positron emission tomography, PET, single photon emission computed tomography, SPECT, and magnetic resonance imaging, MRI. With these techniques, scientists can look at the deep structures and chemical reactions within the brain. We now know that OCD isn't caused by unconscious conflicts, but by abnormalities in the structure, chemistry, and circuitry of the brain. Recent discoveries in neurochemistry and pharmacology have helped scientists link OCD with problems in the regulation of the brain chemical serotonin, which plays a vital role in the control of our moods and behavior. Today, we have 7 medications that help correct such a chemical imbalance. Clomipramine, also known as anafrenil. Fluoxetine, also known as Prozac. Fluvoxamine, also known as Luvox. Paroxetine, also known as Paxil. Citalopram, also known as Celexa. Escitalopram, also known as Lexapro. And sertraline, also known as Zoloft. Most people with OCD will see a reduction of their symptoms with any of these medications. For others, these medications offer only minimal relief, and still other medications may be required to enhance the effectiveness of the first-line drugs. This tells us that serotonin imbalance isn't the only cause. Clearly, there is still a lot more to be learned about brain chemistry and pharmacology as it relates to OCD. Until the 1960s, psychoanalysis was routinely used to treat OCD. As medications began to prove useful in treating OCD, therapy was changing too. In 1966, British psychologist Victor Meyer began using behavior therapy to treat hospitalized OCD patients with severe contamination fears. Meyer and his colleagues combined intensive exposure to feared objects, such as bathroom doorknobs and faucets, with strict restrictions on showering and washing. In fact, he had the water shut off in the hospital unit except to areas used exclusively for toileting. This new, innovative therapy worked, and it worked quickly. After several days of intensive treatment, 14 of his 15 patients had a marked reduction of their OCD symptoms. 10 were greatly improved or symptom-free, and 4 showed moderate improvement. Since then, Numerous studies around the world have demonstrated improvement of OCD symptoms using these behavior therapy techniques, known as exposure and response prevention. Unlike psychoanalytic therapy, which emphasizes the role of hidden unconscious forces in directing our behavior, forces that are out of our control, behavior therapy emphasizes the role of learning in human behavior and focuses on changing behavior by learning new ways of responding. In the 1980s, researchers such as Paul Salkowski and Paul Emmelkamp began to recognize the role of faulty beliefs and attitudes in maintaining OCD symptoms. They applied ideas of cognitive therapy originally developed in the 1960s and 1970s to understanding OCD. Cognitive therapy involves recognizing and disputing the irrational beliefs and faulty thought patterns that result in abnormal behavior. Cognitive therapy was then applied as an adjunct to behavior therapy in the treatment of OCD. Together, this is called cognitive behavioral therapy, CBT. It is the cornerstone of this book and a powerful tool in breaking free from OCD. Breaking free from OCD. After reviewing your struggle with OCD, it wouldn't be abnormal to feel confused, despairing, uncertain, or anxious about your future and about bearing the burden of OCD in your life. In its most severe forms, it can be a truly wretched existence. However, with the advances in the scientific understanding of psychiatric disorders in general and OCD in particular, there is more reason for optimism than ever before. The increasing availability of effective medications and more widespread recognition and use of cognitive behavioral therapy in the treatment of OCD offer an unprecedented level of hope for those with OCD. Obsessive-compulsive disorder has begun to receive a great deal of attention in the media, reflecting an increased acceptance by our culture. People with OCD no longer need to feel ashamed and embarrassed by their problem. Cognitive behavioral therapy has been established as the most effective treatment for OCD. Cherry applied the principles of the OCD workbook and broke free from her OCD. She's not cured. Indeed, there is no cure for OCD as of yet. But her life is no longer ruled by obsessive thoughts and compulsions. At one time, she was seldom free of anxiety and intrusive thoughts during her waking hours. When intrusive thoughts invade, she can dismiss them. Yes, sometimes she checks the door a second time or washes her hands unnecessarily, but she doesn't feel compelled to perform the ritual over and over. It is our firm belief that you too can achieve significant relief from the stranglehold of OCD. The information in this book will provide you with the tools necessary to make this a reality. We have just one caveat. If you also suffer from other mental health disorders, including clinical depression, this can complicate the treatment of OCD. If you suspect your OCD is complicated by another disorder, consult a mental health professional. A comprehensive treatment strategy that addresses each diagnosis will be more successful than focusing only on your OCD. Help for family and friends. Obsessive-compulsive disorder isn't just a personal matter. It also affects family and personal relationships, often in profound ways. This new edition of the OCD Workbook will place additional emphasis on the issues that confront family members and partners of the person with OCD by including a Help for Family and Friends section at the end of each chapter. We've also listed books for family members, friends, and teachers of those with OCD in the resources section, found at the end of the book. In our experience, family members who are open to growing in their understanding of this mysterious and baffling disorder often play a key role in successful recovery. Take a few moments to talk with your loved one about how his or her OCD has impacted your life. As you go through this book, you will undoubtedly discover ways that your interactions with your loved one have been less than helpful. This is normal and to be expected. Find the humility to own up to and acknowledge the mistakes you've made. And find the resolve to learn everything you can to be an effective catalyst in your loved one's recovery. Chapter 2. A closer look at OCD. Symptoms and causes. Although the world is full of suffering, it is full also of the overcoming of it. Helen Keller. In the United States, obsessive-compulsive disorder is the fourth most common psychiatric diagnosis, with a lifetime prevalence rate of up to 2.5%. This means one out of every 40 people in this country, over 7.6 million men, women, and children, may suffer from OCD. As mentioned in Chapter 1, previous estimates were much lower, 0.05 to 0.32%. Estimates today are as much as 50 times greater than in 1964 and 1967. About 65% of people with OCD develop the disorder before the age of 25, and only 15% develop it after the age of 35. There is a slightly higher incidence of OCD in women. However, among children with OCD, boys outnumber girls by about 2 to 1. Obsessive-compulsive disorder exists in every culture and on every continent. What do these statistics mean to the average person with OCD? They provide confirmation that you are not alone. People with OCD tend to keep the illness a secret. As a result, you may not realize how many people have similar problems. Look around you next time you're amidst a large number of people, at a baseball game, concert, or mall, or even waiting in line at the Department of Motor Vehicles. On average, it's likely that one out of 40 people surrounding you has OCD. The onset of OCD symptoms is usually gradual, although some children suffer sudden onset in a form of OCD known as PANDAS, pediatric autoimmune neuropsychiatric disorders associated with streptococcal infections. It isn't uncommon for OCD symptoms to flare up during times of emotional stress at work or at home. Major life transitions such as leaving home for the first time, pregnancy, the birth of a child, the termination of a pregnancy, increased levels of responsibility, health problems, and bereavement may be linked to the onset or worsening of OCD symptoms. The Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders is the diagnostic bible for mental health professionals. In its criteria for a diagnosis of OCD, it states, "The essential features of obsessive-compulsive disorder are recurrent obsessions or compulsions that are severe enough to be time-consuming, i.e., they take more than 1 hour a day, or cause marked distress or significant impairment. At some point during the course of the disorder, the person has recognized that the obsessions or compulsions are excessive or unreasonable." As explained in Chapter 1, obsessions are persistent ideas, images, thoughts, or urges experienced as inappropriate and intrusive, and that cause marked anxiety. People with OCD have the sense that these thoughts aren't within their control, and that they aren't the kind of thought that they would expect to have. They are also aware that the thoughts are a product of their own minds, versus externally imposed, which would be indicative of a psychotic disorder, not OCD. In OCD, the discomfort of an obsessive thought or urge results in attempts to contain or neutralize the discomfort through some repetitive action, performed either covertly with thoughts or overtly with behaviors. Repetitive overt behaviors include ordering, checking, or hand washing, while mental acts may include repeating words silently, praying, or counting. The function of a compulsive ritual or behavior is to reduce the distress that accompanies an obsessive worry or fear. It has the effect of containing, controlling, or neutralizing anxiety. People with OCD don't derive gratification or pleasure from performing their compulsions. They often feel driven to do them to prevent some dreaded situation, usually harm to others or themselves. Compulsions may be related to the content of the obsession, but are clearly excessive, or they may not even be connected in a realistic way with what they are designed to neutralize or prevent. What OCD is not. In order to understand what OCD is, it's important to know what OCD is not. Almost everyone worries, at times excessively. The worries resulting from OCD differ in that they are usually senseless and irrational, and ignoring them makes the person feel anxious and nervous. It is important to distinguish this from worrying that is excessive but rational, which may be a symptom of depression. Similarly, many people are compulsive without having OCD. They give careful attention to details and procedures and are overly concerned with rules, regulations, and doing things the right way. In contrast, the compulsions of people with OCD are senseless and repetitive and are performed to dispel anxiety. Most often, those with OCD consider their compulsions silly, pointless, and troublesome, and even embarrassing and shameful. People aren't always aware of these distinctions, so many forms of repetitive behavior may be mistakenly labeled as OCD, including superstition, ritual, and prayer, substance abuse and compulsive gambling, eating disorders, and obsessive-compulsive personality disorder. Superstitions, rituals, and prayer. It is important to recognize that certain repetitive or ritualistic behaviors may be due to cultural or religious influences, not OCD. The DSM, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, addresses this point. Culturally prescribed ritual behavior is not in itself indicative of obsessive-compulsive disorder unless it exceeds cultural norms, occurs at times and places judged inappropriate by others of the same culture, and interferes with social role functioning. Important life transitions and mourning may lead to an intensification of ritual behavior that may appear to be an obsession to a clinician who is not familiar with the cultural context. Superstitions and repetitive checking behaviors are commonly encountered in everyday life. A diagnosis of obsessive-compulsive disorder should be considered only if they are particularly time-consuming or result in clinically significant impairment or distress. Rituals and repetitive behaviors are part of the normal repertoire of behaviors we all possess. Prayer, for example, can be an important part of our daily lives. Most people perform some ritualistic and repetitive behavior in the normal course of daily life, and many people are superstitious. But when these behaviors take over, resulting in significant impairment, distress, or anxiety, or are excessively time-consuming, OCD could be responsible. In his workshops, OCD expert Robert Ackerman, Master of Social Work, aptly described OCD as a cult of one. Substance abuse and compulsive gambling. Although many problem behaviors are considered compulsive, they don't necessarily fit the clinical definition of OCD, and therefore aren't considered OCD. This is the case with pathological gambling and substance addictions, including addictions to drugs and alcohol. The main difference between OCD and these addictive or impulse control disorders is that the obsessive thoughts and compulsive behaviors of OCD are, for the most part, unwanted and unpleasant. Unlike addictions, OCD brings no anticipation of pleasure or satiation. Again, these behaviors are done to reduce discomfort and worry, not for pleasure. Obsessive-compulsive personality disorder. When we hear the word personality, we generally think of phrases describing people's overall behavior. She has a nice, caring personality. He has a strong, tenacious, domineering personality, and so on. Personality is a consistent, enduring, lifelong set of learned and inherited responses to a multitude of situations and challenges in life. It encompasses characteristics that don't change much throughout the lifespan. When a personality style or a set of features fundamental to a personality causes an excess of stress or difficulty in life, the person is said to have a personality disorder. According to the DSM, people with obsessive-compulsive personality disorder, OCPD, are characterized by a preoccupation with details, rules, lists, orderliness, perfectionism, and mental and interpersonal control at the expense of flexibility, openness, and efficiency. They tend to view the world in black and white, all or nothing terms. There are no gray areas. They often adopt a my way or the highway approach to coworkers and family members, often referred to as truth ownership, that damages and sours these relationships. For these people, it is unacceptable for their performance in any area of life to fall short of perfection. This pattern begins by early adulthood and is present in a variety of contexts in the person's life. In the area of work, people with this disorder tend to be highly efficient, reliable, and organized, but often excessively so. They may get over-involved with the details of a task and lose the forest for the trees. In their personal lives, they spurn change and spontaneity, instead preferring predictability, repetition, and a highly routinized way of life. They tend to keep their emotions and behavior highly controlled and may appear rather cold and aloof to others. Although people with OCD often have features of OCPD, only a small percentage of people with OCD, 6 to 25%, actually have full-blown OCPD. The main difference between OCD and OCPD lies in the degree of life impairment. People with OCD suffer substantially from their problem and they wish to be rid of it. People with OCPD, on the other hand, are rarely uncomfortable about it and seldom feel the need for help for their problems. In fact, they are often unaware of the problem their behavior may be causing until these difficulties are brought to their attention by coworkers or family members who have been adversely affected by their behavior. When a person with OCD also has OCPD, characteristics such as rigidity, perfectionism, and the need for control make it more difficult to change the OCD behaviors. This is mostly due to the reluctance of people with OCPD to accept guidance and intervention from outside themselves, as it implies that they are less than perfect. Unfortunately, when they do reach a point where they are ready to wholeheartedly face their problems, all may seem lost. However, hitting rock bottom often provides the opportunity and motivation to change. Elements of the self-directed program can be useful for people with OCPD. For example, they can use cognitive restructuring, covered in Chapter 8, for perfectionism and truth ownership, and exposure and response prevention to increase their behavioral flexibility in carrying out daily routines. The symptoms of OCD. Although OCD can manifest in a wide variety of ways, the most common symptoms are checking compulsions and washing or cleaning compulsions. Other symptoms include compulsive counting, the need for symmetry, unwanted sexual or aggressive thoughts, the need to constantly seek reassurance, ordering rituals, and hoarding. As discussed in Chapter 1, some people have primarily obsessional OCD, meaning that they have obsessions but no overt compulsions. They are likely to have repetitive, unwanted, and intrusive thoughts of aggressive or sexual acts that are reprehensible to them. Others exhibit primary obsessional slowness, wherein their compulsive rituals and need to perform even the simplest daily tasks just right results in spending hours every day getting washed, dressed, and groomed. The pattern of symptoms in OCD is extremely varied. While many people with OCD have one symptom throughout their lives, Others have multiple obsessions and compulsions. For example, a checker may also be a washer. In addition, the symptoms may alternate and transform over the years. For example, a person with intrusive thoughts in adolescence may get over that problem, only to become a washer in early adulthood, and then become a checker later in life. Identifying your OCD symptoms. In the bonus PDF, you'll find a lengthy, detailed list of OCD symptoms related to obsessions, and another related to compulsions. Recognizing these symptoms can help the person with OCD come out of a self-imposed closet and seek treatment. Go through the lists and check off all of the symptoms that apply to you, or if you prefer, list your symptoms in your journal. Just be sure to record them one way or the other. You'll use this list as you work your way through the self-directed program in this book. Recognizing that you have these symptoms is an important first step in understanding your OCD and developing a treatment plan. And remember, having these symptoms is not sufficient to diagnose a person with OCD. OCD is diagnosed only when these behaviors result in significant impairment, distress, or anxiety, or are too time-consuming. How is OCD diagnosed? The journey of recovery from OCD begins with an accurate diagnosis. If you suspect that you have OCD, you will find this book to be quite helpful in determining whether this is actually the case. If you aren't sure if you have OCD, it is possible that your uncertainty is actually a symptom of OCD. In any case, it's a good idea to obtain an accurate diagnosis from a qualified mental health professional if you haven't already done so. A diagnosis of OCD is made on the basis of a psychiatric or psychological examination, a history of the person's symptoms and complaints, and the degree to which the symptoms interfere with daily functioning. Based on the nature, length, and frequency of the symptoms presented, the mental health professional will differentiate OCD from other conditions with similar symptoms. These include schizophrenia, phobias, panic disorder, and generalized anxiety disorder. A physical exam may be recommended to rule out other possible causes of the symptoms. There is no blood test available to reliably diagnose OCD. So how do mental health professionals distinguish between OCD and those people who just worry a great deal? Studies have shown that 80 to 99% of people experience unwanted thoughts. But most people can hold unpleasant thoughts in their mind without too much discomfort, or they can easily dismiss the thoughts entirely. Their thoughts are shorter in duration, less intense, and less frequent than the intrusive thoughts of people who have OCD. The obsessive thoughts of OCD, on the other hand, usually have a specific onset, produce significant discomfort, and result in a powerful, overwhelming urge to neutralize or lessen them. The obsessions and compulsions of OCD significantly interfere with life. People with OCD recognize that they are excessive or unreasonable, at least most of the time. There are several assessment tools that mental health professionals can use to aid in the diagnosis of OCD. The Yale-Brown Obsessive-Compulsive Scale, YBOCS, is a questionnaire that can help target obsessive-compulsive symptoms and assess their severity. We've included the YBOCS in the appendix to this book. The YBOCS is also used to monitor the person's response to treatment. There is also a children's version of this scale. Other assessment tools include the Compulsive Activity Checklist, CAC, the Latent Obsessional Inventory, LOI, the Maudsley Obsessive-Compulsive Inventory, MOCI, the Padua Inventory, PI, and the National Institute of Mental Health Global Obsessive-Compulsive Scale, NIMH Global OC. OCD and shame. People with OCD are typically secretive and shameful about their obsessive thoughts and compulsive behaviors. Many are successful in hiding their illness for years. Unlike people with many other mental illnesses, those with OCD are aware, at least at times, of their inappropriate behaviors and thoughts. However, they are often unaware that their symptoms are part of a recognizable condition that can be treated. Or they may fear that they'd be scorned, perhaps even locked up, if they were to reveal their obsessions and compulsions to others. Because of this secretiveness, many people wait years, even decades, to seek help. Meanwhile, the obsessive thoughts and compulsive behaviors become more deeply ingrained in their lives. The average time between the onset of symptoms and seeking treatment is over 7 years. Hopefully, further advances in scientific knowledge and understanding of OCD will narrow this time period. Due to the shame people with OCD often feel, many won't consult a mental health professional. They may prefer to seek help from their symptoms from another type of health professional. Alert medical doctors can detect symptoms of OCD in people who come to see them for seemingly unrelated problems, and the family doctor may be the first professional to see signs of OCD in a person. Parents and family members may mention their concern about the person's frequent washing, counting, or checking. Excessive worry about having AIDS or other serious illnesses, resulting in repeated unnecessary tests and consultations, may also alert physicians. Other doctors likely to detect signs of OCD include dermatologists, plastic surgeons, dentists, obstetricians, neurologists, neurosurgeons, orthopedic surgeons, pediatricians, infectious disease internists, and even oncologists. Dermatologists may notice chapped hands and eczema-type conditions due to excessive hand washing. People with perfectly normal appearances may present themselves to plastic surgeons requesting surgery for what they feel are noticeable deformities. A dentist may be alerted by gum lesions from excessive teeth cleaning. An orthopedic surgeon may be consulted for musculoskeletal or joint problems arising from repetitive motion activities, such as repeatedly pressing the refrigerator door to make sure it's shut. Signs of OCD may intensify during pregnancy and postpartum, and therefore be noticed by obstetricians. Neurologists and neurosurgeons see signs of OCD associated with Tourette syndrome, head injury, epilepsy, and other disorders of the nervous system, discussed later in this chapter. The informed physician with a keen eye will detect OCD and make the appropriate referral to a psychiatrist or other mental health professional, rather than dismissing the person as odd or crazy. OCD and depression. Many people with OCD suffer from some degree of depressive symptoms, ranging from mild, the blues, to severe, life-threatening depressive illness characterized by strong, persistent feelings of sadness, hopelessness, helplessness, loss of interest in normal activities and pursuits, lack of energy, impaired sleep and appetite, and suicidal thoughts. At the time they seek treatment, approximately one-third have major clinical depression, the most severely disabling form of depression, and about two-thirds of people with OCD have had at least one episode of major clinical depression in their lifetime. Many others suffer from a lesser form of depression known as dysthymia, a kind of low-grade depressed mood. Most people with OCD who also have dysthymia are depressed because of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.